What's the best way to train for IPPT? Today, I'll be talking about the push-up segment, specifically how to do them properly and how to train yourself. This is so that you can get the maximum reps and maximum points with minimum training. If you want similar content for the sit-up and 2.4 segments, simply subscribe to our channel. We'll be producing more of such videos in the coming weeks, and our main platform will be YouTube, where we'll group the videos in an IPPT playlist. For those that are new here, I'm Tingchi, founder of Allset, a physio and personal training company. My team also builds a coaching platform for fellow physios and trainers. Prior to this, I served in the commando for 10 years as an officer. Even so, I've not come across any science-based, time-efficient IPPT guide. So with the help of my team, we have made one ourselves. This video is part of our Sports Science Simplified series, so I'll attach an article in the description below, where I'll state all the research papers that are referenced. Let's get into it. A proper form will help you during your tests and during your training, so that's where we'll be starting from. Specifically, we'll look at your hand position first. This is because it plays a big role in how you do your push-up. To be clear, the push-up primarily targets your chest and your arm muscles, namely the pec major, triceps, and anterior deltoids. Where you place your hand determines how you'll be using those muscles and how safe the exercise is. For example, researchers in 2013 found that if you place your hands more than 60 degrees away from your body, it may result in shoulder impingement. Down the road, it may then cause pain and injury. They have therefore stated the safer way to do our push-ups is to keep our hands less than 60 degrees away from our body, even if it feels uncomfortable at first. The other thing recommended by researchers is to keep your hands shoulder width apart when doing your push-ups. This is in line with a study done in 2005 that states that the narrow arm position leads to greater chest and tricep activation, which may then result in greater strength gains. As for where along your body you place your hands, it depends on which muscles you like to target. Another research done in 2005 shows that the further back you place your hands, the more triceps you'll use. In contrast, if you place your hands closer to your shoulders, you'll be using more of your chest muscles. To make things easier to remember, the cue will be to form an arrow shape when you view yourself from the top. Once you have formed the arrow shape, the only thing left to align is your finger's direction. For that, researchers recommend pointing your fingers forward or outward, because rotating your fingers inward may lead to excessive shear force on your elbows. One way to prevent this is to press your knuckles down and rotate your hands externally, just like you're tearing apart a piece of paper with both hands. When you do that, you also realize you're engaging more muscles. Your chin will naturally tuck in, keeping your entire body in a nice straight line. After following all these cues, your hands should be around your mid-chest, just outside your shoulders. Your shoulders should also feel like they're in a natural position as opposed to being scrunched up. As for the rest of your body, simply tuck your tailbone in and squeeze your butt gently. This should keep your lower body engaged. Just in case you're wondering, there hasn't been much research on leg position, so do what fits you best. As long as they're engaged, with knees straightened out, we believe you'll be fine. From here, to do a push-up, simply pull the ground towards you to your elbow at 90 degrees, and then push it away. Throughout the whole movement, maintain your form. A common mistake is to let gravity do the work when you go down. Instead, you should actively pull the ground towards you so that you don't need to reset every single rep. That said, remember that during your IPPT, you can adjust your hand positioning to utilize muscles differently. That will help you squeeze out a few extra reps. Next up, I'll be talking about how to train. And for this part, we're going to start off by helping those that can't do 5 reps or standard push-ups. If you can do 5 proper push-ups, simply skip to the following segment. For those watching on YouTube, there'll be timestamps to make things easier for you. If you can't do 5 reps or standard push-ups yet, you can utilize a few versions of assisted push-up to help you out. The key thing here is that we want to aim for the full range of motion during the push-up before we move to more reps. This is partly because if you don't go through the entire range of motion, you won't be activating certain muscles as strongly as you can. During the test, you also need to go close to the ground for your push-up to count. But perhaps more importantly, having strength throughout the entire range of motion improves your day-to-day movement quality. Coming back, there are a few ways you can do your assisted push-ups. We recommend either putting your knees on the floor, doing push-ups at an incline, or placing a band at your hips. There are pros and cons to each variation, and I'll cover them shortly. No matter which one you go with, we recommend you work towards 5 reps of assisted push-ups, and then make a progression. This is because ultimately, we want to do 5 reps of standard push-ups, not assisted push-ups. If you have other goals, like strengthening specific parts of your muscles or general fitness, it might make sense to do more reps of assisted push-ups. But otherwise, to optimize IPPT training, we move on from doing assisted push-ups as quickly as we can. For those starting from knee push-ups, to progress towards standard push-up, simply straighten your leg all the way. This variation, quite obviously, has the largest jump in terms of difficulty. It might work for some people, but otherwise, try doing the incline or bended variation instead. The one I personally guide most of my clients towards is the incline push-ups, simply because it works for most people and it can cater to more subtle progressions. For example, you might start off by doing push-ups on a wall, followed by a bench, and then on the floor. The last method we recommend is to use bands. Specifically, set up a band under your hips, and as you progress, decrease the resistance of the band. The thing with this method is that it requires you to have a place to set up your bands and also multiple bands. If you have all the equipment, this is a great option. Otherwise, there's always my favorite, incline push-ups. Once you're able to do at least 5 standard push-ups, we want to increase your push-up count. This is slightly different from training for absolute push-up strength because we're also aiming for muscular endurance, meaning not just how much weight you can push, but also how many reps you can do. The principle of specificity also states that adaptation of body is specific to the type of training undertaken, meaning that for IPPT purposes, we should incorporate more reps into our training. To be clear, research has shown that your 1 rep max affects how many reps of an exercise you can do, as shown in a study in 2009. That said, further research, like this one done in 2014, has shown that adherence plays a bigger factor in doing your maximum number of reps, especially when the weight is less than 90% of your 1 rep max. When starting your training, we recommend doing a test of how many push-ups you can do. This is partly for progress tracking purposes and partly to determine how many reps you should be doing during your training. Once you know your starting point, aim to do 3 to 5 sets of 80 to 90% effort, preferably at least 2 times each week. A sample training plan will be to increase your rep count every single week for 3 weeks. After 3 weeks of progress, allow for a deload week where you do slightly lesser reps. To continue, repeat a cycle of 3 weeks progress and 1 week deload. For example, if you are doing 10 reps per set in your first week, you can add 3 reps to each set next week, doing 13 reps for each set. For the subsequent week, add another 3 reps, meaning 16 push-ups per set. In your fourth week, you can go back to between 13 to 16 push-ups per set. In between each set, rest for 2 to 5 minutes. The key thing here is not everyone should follow this sample program. It's more important to understand the principles and rationale and adjust the training to suit your needs. Firstly, I mentioned 80 to 90% effort for each set because there's no need to do up to failure each time. This is in accordance to what researchers found in a meta-analysis done in 2019. In that paper, it's also stated that volume matters more. Hence, our recommendation of doing 3 to 5 sets at least twice a week. The other thing I mentioned in the sample training plan is to have a deload week after 3 weeks of progress. In simple terms, the reason for this is to let your nervous system, muscles, and tendons recover. It also gives your body the time to adapt to the training stress. To be clear, there isn't much research on the exact amount you should load before deloading or how long your deloading should be. It's more of something you have to learn to gauge yourself because it changes with context. Too little deloading and you might burn out or get injured. Too much deloading and you won't see progress. The reason I usually deload every 3 weeks is because it makes planning and progress tracking easier. And it works for most people. Lastly, we have mentioned resting 2 to 5 minutes between sets. Now this really depends on how many push-ups you are doing per set. I'm simplifying things here, but if you are doing 5 to 10 reps per set, your workout is more similar to strength training, and your body needs 3 to 5 minutes to recover between sets. On the other hand, if you are training muscle endurance, you should shorten your rest time. If you're interested in the exact science of rest time, let me know. I'll probably touch on it in another video. The last thing I'll cover here is the speed at which you are doing your push-ups. A research done in 2011 has shown that doing your push-up fast will increase shearing force and extension moment at your elbow joint. It might also increase loading at your triceps and increase the chance of injury. On the other hand, another study done in 1994 has also shown that during a max rep test, slowing down to pace yourself will actually lead you to doing lesser push-ups. So the conclusion here is to do your push-up at your comfortable pace. There's no need to speed up and no need to slow down. To end things off, I'd just like to share that there are other interesting research done regarding push-ups. For example, push-up versus bench press, the effectiveness of push-up plus, TRX incline push-ups, etc. I'm sure you have some questions, so feel free to drop them in the comment section below. We'll be happy to answer them. At the same time, if you're committed to improving your IPPT score and would like some professional help, feel free to approach us for personal training. We run a promotion whenever a trainer is coming on board, and it just so happens we're unveiling our next hire soon. So check out our team page on the Allstat website and drop us a message if you want a good deal. That's all for today. Till next time, take care.